Last but not least, I'd like to welcome Catherine Merkley from Children's National Hospital, who will present on transforming safety, improving the daily safety huddle. Catherine, let's begin.
Thank you. All right. So very quickly about Children's National. We are a 323-bed freestanding pediatric teaching facility right in the heart of DC. And we're here today to talk to you about how we improved our daily safety huddle. So where we started, safety huddles we know are really widely accepted best practices in high reliability industries for improving situational awareness and escalating safety risks. So in 2011, Children's National launched what we call the daily check-in, and it was a daily phone call facilitated by the AOC that covered about a 37 department roll call over about 10 minutes. And the goal was to report issues and follow up and escalate those risks. The process was then updated again in 2015. And this was really to ensure that key information, operational information, was reported at the beginning of the call prior to the roll call. And what we found between 2015 and the update that we're going to talk to you about today, through feedback and tracking some of the issues that were reported during the daily call, it was showing increasing disengagement from the participants and low reporting of issues from really some of our highest risk units. So today we're here to talk about our work in 2019, where we really set out to turn this into a venue for real-time problem solving. So the way we went about this, established best practices, identified our gaps, created the structures and processes for the revamped daily check-in. We measured our outcomes and we set up a format for continuous improvement. To start out, we surveyed our participants and this was really telling. We found that only 69% of the participating departments really felt like the daily check-in was an effective venue for resolving issues in real time. And then looking at the issue reporting data over the last several years, we found that only 17% of participants were actually engaged in reporting during the call. This is feedback that we got from one of our actual participants, and we think it sums up the gaps that we found very well. The call was taking too long. There were a lot of reporting departments, and people really weren't getting real-time solutions to their issues. And they didn't feel that when they did report an issue or another department reported an issue, that there was any sort of closed loop follow-up. What did we do? We started by setting up our structures and processes. Taking into account our participants' feedback and the best practices that we learned through high reliability organizations, we set out to start what we call DCI 3.0. We started out by picking a centrally located and highly visible location in our organization. This is called the Bear Institute, and it's right about in the middle of the building with glass walls around it so that everyone can see that we're huddling daily to talk about safety. We also truncated our roll call. We went from 37 departments to 27 with the goal that all operational areas were represented and that the huddle would continue in its in-person format to take 15 minutes or less. And our goal here was to shift this from a phone call to an in-person format, again, with the hopes of making this a real-time problem-solving venue. We also provided guidance on the type of issues that should be reported so that participants had some format to understand what they should be bringing to the call. This might be the most important thing that we did. We created a SharePoint for the daily check-in. And this is managed by a co-facilitator. So we continue to have the daily huddle facilitated by our administrator on call, an executive level facilitator, but they now have a co-facilitator and that person documents on this outstanding issues list, any issues that are reported during the call, who reported them, who is responsible for following up on them, and when that follow-up needs to be brought back to the huddle to ensure that we were getting closed loop on issues that were brought up. And here you have us going live. This was our very first in-person huddle. It took place on November 4th of 2019. It was after many weeks of training and refining our process and continuing to get feedback from our participants, we were finally able to go live. What did we find? We surveyed participants prior to the launch of the in-person huddle, and then we surveyed them at intervals afterwards. And what we found was a significant increase in participants who really felt that the DCI was effective at problem solving in real time. We also found an increase in engagement from the participants. We are getting 50% more reports than we had in the entire year prior to launching the in-person huddle. In accountability and follow-up, we have 464, and actually more now, reports that have been brought to the daily check-in that have closed-loop follow-up, and all participants are aware of how the resolution took place. Engagement. This Pareto chart really just shows that we now have about equal engagement from all of our patient care areas. When we looked at the data prior to our revamp, we found that, like I said, many of our high-risk areas were not engaged, they were not reporting, or they weren't present for the call. And now that everyone is coming together, not only are they present for the call, but they are also bringing those issues forward. So continuous improvement. You know, we didn't want to just stop when things got better. So in November 19, we launched the in-person huddle. In December through March, we really measured our outcomes and continued to kind of refine our process through multiple PDSA cycles. And then in March 2020, while we were excited about the success of the in-person huddle, like the rest of the country, we were impacted by COVID and could no longer have this group of people coming together. And we had to transition very, very quickly. We had about less than 12 hours to make this happen to a virtual format. Because we had designed the SharePoint and the outstanding issues list and the role of the co-facilitator to help sort of manage all of those logistic pieces, we were able to transition very quickly to Zoom and continue the huddle almost exactly as it was being done in person. And then in July 2020, we combined our COVID-19 huddle and we integrated one of our hospitals, HSC, into the daily check-in. So what did we learn? If you establish the right structures and processes, you can improve engagement, accountability, real-time problem solving, and you can improve overall organizational situational awareness, which in turn reduces harm. And I'll leave you with this quote. This was from one of our participants, I think it was 6 weeks after we went live, about how they felt that this new revised huddle had transformed our daily safety. Thank you.
Thanks, Catherine. It was really interesting to see hear how you adapted based on feedback. Were there specific challenges you encountered with such a large huddle?
So yes, probably the biggest one, I would say the biggest challenges came before we actually went live, our November 4th go live. We had a lot of feedback around time. People thought that it was going to take a long time for them to get to the location, and that's purposely why we picked that central location. So everyone was sort of coming from the same distance and no one had a longer travel time than others. We got a lot of feedback about the fact that they really thought the call was going to take too long, and that people were going to go off topic or use it for items other than just escalating safety risks. And as we did a lot of training. We did simulation training beforehand with all the participants, with all of our administrators on call who are facilitating. We were able to work through a lot of those kinks as people actually walked through it. They were able to see that it wasn't going to take as long as they thought, or getting there wasn't going to take as long as they thought. And then as we went live, we continued to kind of hear this feedback along the way, but it got to be less and less. And then people started showing up earlier and earlier. You know, no one was late. No one was walking in. No one was hijacking the call or the huddle for purposes other than to escalate safety. And no one was leaving. You know, that was one of the things with the phone calls. People would give their report, they'd hang up, they'd be gone. What we started to hear as the process got up and going was, oh no, like you just saved me 30 emails today, or now I don't have to go find so-and-so to get this fixed. You know, those conversations are happening in real time.
Right. Well, it's interesting. We were talking about culture earlier today and yesterday, and it's interesting that how changing how you had it set up really did change the culture of how people interacted with the meeting. You're pointing out, you know, they showed up early or on time and they didn't leave early, you know, and that's sort of changing what people think of as the culture of what's acceptable for the meeting. And it sounds like it was because the meeting was actually successful and worth people's time. And I'm thinking about other huddles like this that I participated in with hospitals I worked with in the past, with so many different departments attending the huddles. How do you manage that interaction? Do you have assigned representatives where they bring up certain things? Do they have coaching, or how do you sort of manage that to keep that time and to keep that culture, you know, that working?
So we gave them guidance on what topics should be reported or could be reported. We by no means just limit people to those topics. We've gotten a little bit of everything since we've started. But what we ask the departments to do is to just make sure they have one representative there and that person brings that pertinent information. And all of the departments kind of decide who they want to come on their own. They have their own setups for that. They do their own huddles. If there's information or risks that were brought up in their own huddles, they bring those to this centralized huddle. When we were actually faster in person than we were on a phone, much faster. I don't have a perfect answer for why that is. I don't know if there's something about being in person. People are much more succinct.
Maybe it's the reason they call them a stand-up. If you make everybody stand, yeah. They don't want to stand for too long. Although I will say, even in this virtual world, having video versus phone or people with their videos off, you can see the nonverbal cues and know when somebody wants to try to speak up in a way that's a little different than when it's just on the phone, which seems to make a difference. I'm hypothesizing here, no standardized research study, full disclosure, but I wonder if that's part of it.
Well, and we were purposeful about when we made the rapid transition to the virtual format, having a Zoom and not just having a dial-in. And still displaying, you know, the whole group can see the outstanding issues list. The facilitator and the co-facilitator are able to communicate through that. So we were purposeful about making sure that we had that set up and we didn't just take it to the phone because we thought we would lose that.
Great. Thanks. Thanks so much for sharing this. I know lots of organizations tackle this and sometimes it's easier said than done. And it seems like you've figured out some good tricks. So we appreciate you sharing this. Thanks so much.
Thank you.